I'm Vikram Jaswal. I'm an associate professor of psychology at the University of Virginia. For the past 3 years, I've been teaching this two-semester seminar called The Science and Lived Experience of Autism. We try to explore the tension between what the science says about autism and what the lived experience of autism is like.
We work as a class of about 16 students with a partner cohort of non-speaking autistic individuals.
They don't use spoken language reliably, or in some cases, at all. And something that happens as these guys are spelling out their responses is that the non-autistic participants, we all learn to slow down.
What we do is we come prepared with a reading or maybe a video clip that we've all watched, and then we spend the entire day kind of digging into what we got out of it, both from a neurotypical perspective and an autistic perspective. They basically showed that there was no significant eye fixation difference between the two groups, which is a very surprising finding.
A, C, T. I find the obsession with eye contact and G to be annoying. M, A, L. I believe it is about NTs wanting us to look normal.
One of the goals is to get students to think about, what do you do when the science doesn't match the lived experience?
It's a really wide misconception that if you're not displaying interest in a neurotypical way, if you're not, for instance, making eye contact, or you're not verbalizing something that you want to verbalize, you're just not interested in engaging.
But when you actually talk to these guys and you spend time with them, you find that for many of them, nothing could be further from the truth. They're longing for social connection, they want to make friends, but their bodies just aren't able to cooperate in a way that allows them to do it.
I think the most shocking thing continues to be how wrong I was about what it looks like to be listening and what it looks like to be interested.
For the most part, the educational experience of autistic folks is one of separation from their typically developing peers. And I see our seminar as an example of how we can create an inclusive educational environment. Part of what has to happen is for society to make accommodations, for the neurotypical folks to learn ways to support autistic people as they are.
If we come in with a baseline of, let's just see what this person can do, trust their capabilities, trust their interest, then I think we create way more inclusive spaces because we don't bring in all of these preconceived notions about what someone can and can't do.